Mike Hartzell got a call in the middle of the night one night in 2003. It was his old friend, Mohan Srivastava, calling from Toronto, Canada. Mohan told him that he could see a pattern in scratch lottery tickets. Hartzell's immediate reaction was to believe his friend. That's because he's known Mohan for over 30 years. Hartzell knew that when it came to statistics, Mohan didn't make mistakes. He had told Hartzell that he could identify winners from a particular scratch-off lottery ticket without doing any scratching. How was Mohan able to do it? Mohan happily admits that he was a nerd growing up. As a high school student, he claims that he was actually stuffed inside lockers by school bullies. But his smarts didn't go to waste. First of all, there was the computer class he took in high school. One of his assignments was to write a computer program for none other than Tic-Tac-Toe. Mohan also had a natural interest in cryptology. It's not by chance that he had a friendship with mathematician William Tute, who was a famous British codebreaker who cracked a high-level Nazi code during World War II. He received degrees from MIT and Stanford University. Afterwards, he started his career as a geostatistical consultant. He helps international mining companies figure out where to drill. The skills he uses for work are the same exact ones he used to figure out flaws in lottery tickets. A typical assignment for Mohan is basically him trying to figure out where the gold is. A mining company has multiple samples from a potential gold mine. Each sample gives a different estimate of the amount of different minerals that's underneath. Mohan's job is to interpret those samples. It all may seem random, as if the gold is just scattered everywhere, but Mohan knows where the gold actually isn't random at all. According to him, there are fundamental geologic forces that created those numbers. If Mohan can get a hold of a sample, he can decipher it and figure out how much gold is underground. It's the same logic that could be applied to the lottery, according to Mohan. To him, the apparent randomness of a scratch-off ticket was just a mirage, since it's a mathematical lie. Mohan played the lottery for the first time back in June of 2003. A few lottery tickets were given to him as a gag gift. The very first ticket he played was a loser, but on the second scratch-off, a game called Tic-Tac-Toe, he won $3. At first, he wasn't interested in the money. He was just genuinely interested in how the tickets were made, since it was so similar to what he encountered at work. That was why Mohan started trying to figure out how lottery games were put together. He had to follow his hunch that he knew the way that Tic-Tac-Toe was made. Most people just see a bunch of numbers when they look at a scratch-off lottery ticket. But for Mohan, he saw different things. He could see patterns if they're there. For this particular scratch-off game, Ontario's Tic-Tac-Toe Lottery, Mohan noticed it immediately. That's because Mohan understood statistics inside and out. Lottery tickets are, of course, mass-produced for the public. That meant that the lottery uses a program to come up with random numbers. But according to Mohan, that's not possible because the lottery officials need to control the number of winning tickets. The game can't be truly random. He insists that there's nothing random about the lottery. Instead, the game needs to just look random while actually being carefully determined, according to Mohan anyways. Fundamentally, he believes that creating uncrackable lottery tickets is extremely difficult, if not impossible. He decided to buy a few more Tic-Tac-Toe lottery tickets to see if he was right. He bought 25 more Tic-Tac-Toe scratch-offs over the next few days, all from different stores. It turned out that he was right. He could pick the winners with over 90% accuracy because of what he knew. The design was straightforward. On the right were 8 Tic-Tac-Toe boards. On the left was a box with hidden numbers called your numbers. It only took a few hours of studying tickets for Mohan to use his statistical knowledge to discover a defect in the game. The visible numbers revealed essential information about the hidden your numbers that needed to be scratched off. The objective is just like Tic-Tac-Toe. If 3 of your numbers appeared on a board in a straight line, the ticket was a winner. The trick itself is so simple. He taught it to his daughter, who was 8 at the time. Each ticket had 8 Tic-Tac-Toe boards, and each space of the total 72 spaces contained an exposed number from 1 to 39. Some of these numbers were repeated multiple times. The numbers themselves were meaningless. What mattered was whether or not a number was repeated. That told Mohan nearly everything he needed to know. He didn't look at the ticket as a sequence of 72 random digits. Instead, he categorized each number according to how often it showed up on the ticket. He was looking for what he called singletons, which were numbers that appeared only once on the visible Tic-Tac-Toe boards. When these singletons lined up 3 in a row, the chances that the ticket was a winner was through the roof. Mohan was able to figure out what was was a winner or not, without having to do any scratching. Mohan quickly calculated to see how much money he could make from this information. He concluded that it would be way more hassle than it was worth. He calculated he could make around $600 a day doing it, but Mohan made more money as a consultant, and he found that work much more interesting. He decided to let the lottery authorities know there was something wrong with their game instead. He wanted other players to have a fair chance at a fair game. He figured that there had to be other people who figured out the trick just like him. Also, he did it as a business project as well. The lottery may have been interested in hiring consultants like him to make sure their games are fair. At first, lottery officials didn't pay any attention to him. Mohan felt like they were brushing him off. They simply didn't return his calls and messages. So Mohan decided he would show them the problem in a live test. He bought 20 tickets and put them into two piles, the winners and losers. He then wrote the lottery officials a letter listing the serial numbers of each ticket and whether it was going to be a winner or a loser. He sent the package containing the Tic-Tac-Toe scratch-off tickets and his letter to the official lottery offices. Finally, lottery officials paid attention. Just a short 2 hours later, he got a phone call from the security team from Ottawa Lottery and Gaming. Within days, the Ottawa Lottery pulled the game from their retailers. The official explanation by the Ontario Lottery and Gaming Corporation was that the Tic-Tac-Toe game suffered from a, quote, design flaw, but they insisted none of their other scratch-off games were impacted. Mohan spent the next few months testing other Tic-Tac-Toe tickets around Canada and the U.S. He found out another Tic-Tac-Toe game from Colorado was able to be cracked, although at less of an accurate rate. He also found another game that he could predict winners with roughly 65 to 70% accuracy. That was another scratch-off game in Ontario called Super Bingo. The ticket was pulled off the shelves as a precautionary measure, but Ontario lottery officials for that game were unable to prove Mohan's theory that the game was flawed. In the U.S. and Canada, the vast majority of lottery tickets are produced by a handful of companies. These companies do the development, algorithm design, and production of the different scratch-off tickets. The state lotteries basically depend on their expertise. These companies acknowledge that they're constantly concerned about players hacking the tickets they print. They're concerned about everything from the barcodes on the tickets to the hidden ink that they use on the tickets. They're always trying to stay one step ahead of the people who take advantage of the tickets. They insist that they're always looking for new methods of encryption and protection, but they still insist that all their tickets are secure. Here's what Mohan would do if he decided to crack the lottery as a career. It's also his guess on what a criminal organization may do to crack the lottery. Essentially, it's a matter of scale. He'd first create a scanner that would be able to read all the tickets at a much faster rate. Then, he'd just buy huge amounts of tickets to scan. Plenty of people buy lottery tickets in bulk to give away as prizes for contests. Then, according to Mohan, he'd simply return the tickets to retailers that weren't winners. He had asked several Toronto retailers if they would be fine with him exchanging unused, unscratched tickets. No one said no. Nobody was even suspicious. But why? It's because all the retailers just simply assumed that the games are secure and unbreakable. For example, the Massachusetts Lottery has a history of paying out large prizes to suspected criminals. In 1991, famous mob boss James Whitey Bulger and three other associates cashed in a winning lottery ticket worth $14.3 million. Authorities suspected that Bulger was using the lottery to launder his cash. The problem for criminals such as Bulger is that most lotteries only return 53 cents on average for each dollar put in. They had to figure out where to find break-even or profitable games. Maybe they have people working around the clock trying to crack the lottery in order to find a profitable or at least break-even lottery game to launder their illegal profits. In the end, none of the lottery authorities were interested in fixing the problems he found. One association even threatened him with a lawsuit. Today, Mohan says there's almost no doubt that there are scratch-off tickets that are flawed on store shelves. He thinks that the problem is a big one, but lottery officials don't see it the same way. They think that manufacturers are always one step ahead of the lottery hackers and that games are always secure. Here's what's next.